Good morning and welcome to the Brazil Church of the Nazarene. Are you ready to worship?
But first, a few announcements.
A men's barbecue will be held Saturday, June the 26th. See the insert in your bulletin for more details.
The time for the youth Bible study will be changing during the summer months. The new time will be Thursday from 1 to 3 in the afternoon. Megan is planning a yard sale in the church parking lot to help fund summer activity expenses for teens. It will be Saturday, June 12th, 9 a.m. to 3 p.m. Donations are appreciated. SWID Summer Youth Camp applications are due this Tuesday.
The results of the church board elections can be found in the bulletin. Pastor would like to meet with the newly elected board down at the front of the sanctuary following the service.
Deanna Draper has been serving in the nursery by herself during the pandemic to ensure safety and consistency. Now that restrictions are lifting, she feels that it is safe to involve others again. If you were a nursery worker in the past, or if you would like to serve in this ministry, please talk to Deanna.
This past Wednesday, we began our Children's Bible Club. The ministry is off to a great start. If you would like to help out by donating snacks, please see the sign-up sheet on the church bulletin board.
On June 27th, we will be having our annual Faith Promise service. Friends from Beijing, China will be sharing with us during the Sunday school hour and during morning service. Mark your calendars and don't miss this special service.
Today, our virtual hello ministry will be for Vicki Beto. She attended our church for a brief time before residing in a nursing home. Visit the room at the end of the coat racks and make her day by sending some happy words of encouragement.
Good morning, everybody. It's good to see everybody. Let's stand up.
Standing on the promises of Christ my King, through eternal ages let his praises ring. The glory in the highest I will shout and sing. Standing on the promises of God, standing, standing, standing on the promises of God my Savior, standing. The standing on the promises that cannot fail. When the howling storms of doubt and fear assail, by the living word of God I shall prevail. Standing on the promises of God, standing, standing, standing on the promises of God Savior, standing, standing, I'm standing on the promises of God, standing on the promises I cannot fall, listening every moment to the Spirit's call, resting in my Savior as my all in all, standing on the promises of God, standing, standing, standing on the promises of God, my Savior, standing, standing, I'm standing on the promises of God.
No tag. So next year for quizzing, we're going over Romans, so I've kind of been brushing up on it. And in the beginning, he's giving his introduction to the Romans, saying that he's been all over the region, but he kept trying and trying to get to Rome, because he's Roman, Paul is Roman, and he wants to go there, and he wants to preach, but he's just not coming from Greece, and he says, I'm obligated to both the Greeks and the non-Greeks, to both the wise and the foolish. That's why I am so eager to preach the gospel also to you who are in Rome. For I am not ashamed of the gospel, because it is the power of God that brings salvation to everyone who believes, first to the Jew, then to the Gentile. For in the gospel, the righteousness of God is revealed, a righteousness that is by faith from first to last, just as it is written, the righteous will live by faith.
Praise you this morning. You are holy, and we come together this morning just to be here in your presence. We thank you for that, Lord. We thank you for the freedom to come here and worship you. Help us to just pay attention this morning and to listen to what you have to say. Open our hearts and our minds and our ears. Be with us. Amen.
Open my eyes that I may see glimpses of truth thou hast for me. Place in my hands the wonderful key thou shalt unclasp and set me free. Silently now I wait for thee. Ready, my God, thy will to see. Open my eyes, illumine me. That I may hear voices of truth thou sendest clear. And while the wave notes fall on my ears, everything false will disappear. Silently now I wait for thee. Ready, my God, to see. Open my eyes, illumine me, Spirit divine. Open my mouth and let me bear gladly the warm truth everywhere. Open my heart and let me prepare children thus to share. Silently now I wait for thee. Ready, my God, thy will to see. Open my eyes, illumine me, Spirit divine.
You may be seated.
Oh, I'm just checking you all out. That's okay, isn't it? All right. Good to have you here today. Memorial Day weekend. Kids are out of school. Well, they're real excited about that. Adults get a day off. Some of them do. Memorial Day. Right? Get paid. Stay at home. Or go visit relatives. I think some of our folks are camping and visiting and whatever this weekend. Anyway, glad you're here. Good to be able to share God's word with you as we look at Mark chapter 10. And good day. Got nice and cool last night. You gave your air conditioner a break. Some of you turned on heat this morning as we did in here. And before the day's over, you'll be running air conditioner again. It's spring in Indiana. The cicadas are here. You can eat them. And just don't eat the shells. There's not much nutrient in those, but you got to get the ones with the eyeballs on them, with the wing. Pull off the wings, and it's going to be all right. Somebody said with inflation, or the cost of buying groceries has gone up, and God provided cicadas. So you guys just enjoy. Amen. Oh, boy. All right. Good stuff. Now that you found our passage, it's also on the screen. We got Matthew 10 and or Mark 10. Now they were on the road, Jesus and the disciples, going up to Jerusalem. Jesus is going before them, and they were amazed. And as they followed, they were afraid. Then Jesus took the 12 aside again and began to tell them things that would happen to him. Behold, we are going up to Jerusalem, and the Son of Man will be betrayed to the chief priests, to the scribes. They will condemn him to death, deliver him to the Gentiles, and they will mock him and scourge him and spit on him and kill him. And the third day he will rise again. And now let's stand for our text. Verse 45. I forgot to have you stand earlier. I'm sorry. And we will read verse 45. In between time, we have James and John wanting to be on the right hand and the left hand when he comes to the kingdom of God. So he's addressing that. At the end of that, he makes this statement, verse 45. For even the Son of Man did not come to be served, but to serve and to give his life a ransom for many. Lord Jesus, help us as we look to your word again today. And we thank you. We love you. In Jesus' name. Amen. You may be seated. In honor of Memorial Day, I'd like to start by reading from a good author that I enjoy when it comes to biblical stories and otherwise. Max Lucado and the Angels Were Silent. And it was written in 1992. And He wrote this: the decision had been made. The troops had been deployed. The battleships were on their way. Nearly 3 million soldiers were preparing to slam against Hitler's Atlantic Wall in France. D-Day was set in motion. Responsibility for the invasion fell squarely on the four-star shoulders of General Dwight D. Eisenhower. The general spent the night before the attack with the men of the 101st Airborne. They called themselves the Screaming Eagles. As the men prepared their planes, checked their equipment, Ike went from soldier to soldier. I guess they were really paratroopers mostly, offering words of encouragement. Many of the flyers were young enough to be his sons. He treated them like they were. A correspondent wrote that as Eisenhower watched the C-47s take off and disappear into the darkness, his hands were sunk deeply into his pockets and his eyes were full of tears. If you remember, they were the first ones to go. And they dropped them behind the lines to secure the bridges and the facilities back there in order for when the punch came on the beach, they would be able to progress afterwards and all that would not be destroyed. So he was watching the first group, the paratroopers, take off. It's interesting that the 101st were dumped everywhere. A lot of them couldn't even find a lot of their own group. I like World War II. But we get back to his story. So we have him, hands sunk deeply in his pockets, his eyes full of tears. The general then went to his quarters and sat at his desk. He took a pen and paper, and wrote a message. A message which would be delivered to the White House in the event of a defeat. It was brief as it was courageous. Quote, our landings have failed. The troops, the air, and the Navy did all that bravery and devotions to duty could do. If any blame or any fault attaches itself to the attempt, it was mine alone. He writes, it could be argued that the greatest act of courage that day was not in a cockpit or a foxhole, but at a desk when the one at the top took responsibility for the ones below. When the one in charge took the blame even before the blame needed to be taken. Rare leader, this general. Unusual, this display of courage. He modeled the quality seldom seen in our society of lawsuits, dismissals, and divorces. Most of us are willing to take credit for the good we do. Some are willing to take the rap for the bad we do. But few will assume responsibilities for the mistakes of others. Still fewer will shoulder the blame for mistakes not yet committed. Eisenhower did. As a result, he became a hero. Then his next sentence changes the whole story. Jesus did. As a result, he is our Savior. Before the war began, he forgave. Before a mistake could be made, forgiveness was offered. Before blame could be given, grace was provided. The one at the top took responsibility for the ones at the bottom. In Mark 10:45, Jesus described to his disciples what he came to do. For even the Son of Man did not come to be served, but to serve and to give his life a ransom for many. Jesus was the creator, the commander in chief of the universe. Yet he was also the sacrificial savior for our world. Notice the outline found in these words of Jesus. The Son of Man did not come to be served, but to serve and to give his life a ransom for many. The first point is Jesus' purpose was to serve. It was his service. For even the Son of Man did not come to be served, but to serve. See, our usual conception of a leader is a person who orders other people around. Jesus does not fit this description. Jesus told his followers that his goal in life was to be a servant. This was completely different than what the Jewish people expected. The Jewish people wanted a commander who would gather an army and lead them to victory. He would ride a splendid horse and carry a sword in his hand, and they would defeat all of Israel's enemies and then rule the world from the throne in Jerusalem. And all the people of the world would bow before him, and all of them would say Israel's the greatest nation in the world, and so on. But Jesus had a different goal. His throne would soon be in heaven. And someday every knee will bow before him. But his mission on earth was not about a throne. His mission on earth was about service. It was to serve mankind. Look at John 10:32, which is where we started our reading. It said, now they were on the road going up to Jerusalem, and Jesus was going before them, and they were amazed. As the disciples are walking toward Jerusalem for this final time, when Jesus was about to be crucified, Jesus is leading the group. As they're going up, he is going before them. And this is unusual, and you don't see this in Scripture. Wherever Jesus is leading, he's always in the middle of the group. Peter's probably leading, or some of the others. We got to get to the next place. You know, you have your detail people in the discipleship group. But what's Jesus doing? Who touched me? What's going on? Look at these children. Look at the lily over there. That's a teaching moment. Oh, and this beggar is calling out, and the blind man wants help. And I mean, he's constantly touching and teaching and dealing with issues around him. He's never leading the group. In fact, he's dragging the group and slowing them down because he's in amongst the people. But this time it's different. This time, Jesus is marching into battle against the forces of evil. He knew he was going to die. He knew this was his mission from God. He had come to earth to serve humanity, and he came to sacrifice his life. These were the final steps of God's salvation plan. Jesus' steps on that dusty road heading toward Jerusalem had been planned by God from the moment that Adam and Eve sinned in the garden. Jesus came to die so humanity could find a way to win the war against Satan and sin through Jesus Christ. That's our only way. I've been to the Alamo down in Texas. I was disappointed. Town's grown up around the site. There's just a little spot there. It says, this is the Alamo. They have the mission chapel, you know. But that story intrigues me, and you've probably seen the John Wayne version. But the story is interesting. 183 men, surrounded, some say, by as many as 6,000 Mexican soldiers with all their equipment, cannons and horses. And those that were there were volunteers for the most part. They followed men like Davy Crockett and others and came in to fight for their country. One of the volunteers was James Bonham. He was a young lawyer from South Carolina. Came down to be there. He was given the job to slip through the enemy's ranks, which he did, and slipped out to get help. He rode for help. He went to Goliad and made his plea there, and they were not ready. We don't have enough troops. We can't. So he went on to Victoria and begged again for help. No response. We're not ready. We can't. Not yet. We need more troops. There's no way. So with time running out and knowing now there was 182 left behind, James turned around his horse and rode back to the Alamo with no help, but he went back to die. And he knew he was riding back to his own death. See, Jesus is walking towards Jerusalem. He's leading the group. He's going towards his death. And he walked with that purpose to serve us, to serve humanity by giving his life. He died for our sins. His purpose was his service. His price was his sacrifice. Jesus stated in our text, for even the Son of Man did not come to be served, but to serve and to give his life. With his final mission of death on his mind, Jesus stops the group and told them for the third time what this last week would bring. Verse 33, 34, he gets very specific. Behold, we are going up to Jerusalem. The Son of Man will be betrayed to the chief priests, to the elders, or to the scribes. They will condemn him to death and deliver him to the Gentiles, which is the Romans. And they will mock him and scourge him and spit on him and kill him. And the third day he will rise again. Jesus gave them detailed knowledge of what was coming. The where, we're going to Jerusalem. Who? Us and the chief priests and the scribes. And the Gentiles, which is the Romans. And he told them what would happen. He would be betrayed. He used the word condemn. Delivered him up to the Gentiles. They would be mocked, scourged, spit upon, and killed. None of this had happened yet. Jesus knew what was going to happen, so forget any speculation Jesus was trapped, or Jesus messed up, or he really didn't know what was going on. He got caught in the things. No, he's telling them on the way, this is what's going to take place. He went to the cross and he died on purpose. Just as James Bond turned his horse around and rode back to the Alamo on purpose. That's a human way of thinking about how Jesus was going, knowing. He also knew about his resurrection because he said at the end, and the third day he will rise again. But he knew that was coming too. He knew the whole event before he even faced it. He knew the betrayal of one of his own disciples. And he warned him a number of times. He knew about the trial, the mockery, the flogging, the spit, the crucifixion, the resurrection. And yet he went on anyway. He went on purpose. Why? Why? Because he was going to sacrifice himself for our sins. He wanted to pay the price for us. Jesus' price was his sacrifice on the cross. His purpose was a service, his price was a sacrifice. The third thing, his product is our salvation. For even the Son of Man did not come to be served, but to serve and to give his life a ransom for many. It's interesting, some of these words, they change them in some of the, I talked to you last week about remission. For the remission of sins, and it's how we have cancer, we're remission from cancer and other diseases and stuff. And, you know, it was kind of a cool concept to me. I'm a remission. I'm in remission from sin. And it's kind of thought process went with me. We can say I'm forgiven and that's fine. But I was a sinner and I'm living in remission. That doesn't mean it's not going to come back. That's up to me. But right now I'm in remission. Anyway, this is one of those words, a ransom for sinners. See, ransom presents the idea of an exchange. Ransom money is being paid to free a slave, or ransom for a person who gets abducted. You know, ransom, an exchange. In this case, he says, ransom for many. His life, his gift, his sacrifice is a ransom for many. It's an exchange, the life of one giving in place of the death of many. The wages of sin is death. Everyone deserves to die. We've broken God's law. Jesus died as a ransom for the many. In this exchange, the life of an innocent Jesus will be given in substitute for the deaths of all guilty humanity. The one for the many. I grasp that concept. The innocent for the guilty. Now we recognize the sacrifices of our military men and women who died for the cause of right and liberty. But even that's under attack. Someone wanted to change Memorial Day to, what was it? Not white supremacy. Oh, the phrase escapes me. Imperialism Day. Because we forced our will on all these countries around the world. It's disgusting. No, we're honoring our military today because they have protected us. Amen. They died in the cause of right and liberty so that you and I can meet here today in freedom. How much longer that's going to last, I don't know. But I thank God for my two uncles in World War II and others who have served since then, my father-in-law in the Vietnam War. This is reality, and for some of you who have served. My uncle died with shrapnel, still buried in his body, years later. They could not remove it all. Jesus gave himself so that the salvation from sin and death might be possible for every person on planet Earth. And while we honor the military who died for the cause of right and liberty, yet many bypass the sacrifice of Jesus for the freedom from sinful bondage. They act like it's no big deal. This is a big deal. Just as our military is a big deal, so Jesus' death is a big deal. His salvation is many times ignored now. This free gift of Jesus. His cross has been disgraced. His name is used in cursing. The big deal has been brought down, because that's what we do today. We take what's up over there and we bring it down and we stomp on it and make it like it's no effect or it doesn't really matter anymore. We can stomp on our military. We can stomp on Jesus. But one day it's not going to happen anymore, because every knee is going to bow and every tongue is going to confess that Jesus Christ is Lord. And the interesting thing is, the only reason we can stomp on it is because we have the freedom that those men died for. And we have the freedom that Jesus died for, to get by with it. Because if you were in some countries today, you couldn't stomp on it. They would kill you. It's amazing to me how people abuse the freedoms God has given them against the people who gave it to them. And if that's happening in our country in the political sense, it's also happening in our country in the spiritual sense, because we're ignoring the one who made it possible for you and I to live. And we take his name in our curses. See, General Eisenhower took responsibility for his army's possible defeat before it even was defeated. And it wasn't. But Jesus went further. He didn't write a note. He died on a cross. He is the God who died for the sinner, for our wrong choices, for our willful disobedience of God's orders. And yet the sinner has been granted the right to deny his sacrifice, to deny his offer of salvation. Who does that? Think of anybody who would give his life for the behalf of the entire world's population, and yet give you the right to say, I don't want that. I'm not going to accept it. It's unheard of. But God loved us so much that he gave us the ability to choose. I think about that and I say, I'd have never done it. But I'm not God. No wonder when the time comes and we're all standing before the throne and we're each being called individually to give an account. No wonder God's not going to bat an eye when we have not accepted Jesus. He's done everything he possibly could to make it possible for us to have eternal life with him forever in heaven. And a person who rejects that has rejected their own life, their own eternal life. Oh, that won't be a loving God. That's a very loving God. we killed his son and rejected his offer of salvation. That's a different perspective, perhaps. But it's real. When we get there and see Jesus, we're just going to fall flat on our faces because of what he did. If anything that we have done in this life was worth getting any kind of accolade or any kind of title or any kind of crown, we'll cast it at his feet. Because Jesus is the only one who makes it possible. For even the Son of Man did not come to be served, but to serve and to give his life a ransom for many. His purpose was to serve. His price was to sacrifice himself on the cross. His product is our salvation from sin to eternal life. Tomorrow, our nation will recognize the deaths of the many who died for the many. And it's worth honoring them. The many who died for the many. But today, we recognize the death of one who died for the salvation of many. Both are important. But if you have to pick between the two, Jesus is crucially important. Those men who died believed in religious freedom. Jesus died to bring us salvation. Have you accepted God's salvation? Have you exchanged your sins? Your pending death for his offer of salvation and eternal life. It's a good day to remember not only what men have done, but what God has done for us. It's family altar time, and as our musicians and praise team gets ready, I just want to allow us to reflect a little bit about what this is all about. It's about Jesus. It's about him. King of kings, Lord of lords, became man, died for you, so that you can have salvation from sin and eternal life. And Lord, as we pause this moment and open up the altar for family altar time, we realize there's people here to come and talk to you about all kinds of things. But one of the things we need to remind ourselves of is the sacrificial Savior, the one who gave himself so that we can be here this morning. Lord Jesus, we thank you for that. As we pray about our family, our finances, our future, our issues, our problems, but Lord, we just need to put you first. That's a good place to start this week, putting Jesus first. Thank you, Lord Jesus, for coming and dying for us. Thank you now for a time and opportunity to respond to you. Open our hearts. Help us to say yes. In Jesus' name. Let's stand together. Respond to the Holy Spirit. Pray to him.
Trust what you say.
trust what you say, that you're good and your love is great.
We thank you, Jesus. We get this opportunity to talk to you today, to share, Lord, what you've done and what you're continuing to do. You came 2,000 years ago, you made a difference, but you're still working. Even when I don't see it, you're working. Even when I don't feel it, you're working. You never stop working. Even today, you're talking to people and answering prayer. Lord Jesus, we love you. So, Lord, we give ourselves back. We seek you. We celebrate you. We serve you, Lord, because you are in our lives. Begin to work in our community, we pray. Begin to work across our state and across our country and out in our world. Begin to turn things around one more time, we pray. Oh, God, we ask largely. We ask boldly. We ask big today because we can see a world that needs God. And Lord, we're praying for an unleashing of your spirit. We're praying, Lord, today for a new, fresh awareness of what God is working in our lives. Lord, help us to break free from the depressions and the doubts and the fears and the discouragements that have hounded us for so long now. It's time, oh God, for us to realize there's a God who dies to save, to heal, to transform. And Lord, if you can do it, for a Peter, if you can do it, Lord, for me, you can do it for everyone here. You can do it for the entire world. We believe that you want everyone to be saved. And we are thankful and grateful that we're part of the body of Christ today. Now, Lord, ignite us with the fire and the sensation that we need to share the good news with others. Give us opportunities not to keep it to ourselves, but help us in our sphere of influence to make work and school and in the marketplace, the Walmart, whatever it is, a better place because we are taking God there. Amen. Help us, Lord, to carry him to the restaurants and to our barber or whatever it is, Lord. Help us to carry Jesus because there's a world out there that's just beat up. And they need Jesus Christ. And thank you, Lord, that you have the answer. Be now in our worship time of our service. And thank you, Lord, for hearing our prayers. And thank you, Lord, for men and women who are still serving in our military. And thank you, Lord, for Jesus, who is our King of Kings and Lord of Lords. We will follow your commands. We will obey your will. We love you. In Jesus' name. Amen. Let's worship.
You may.
I don't know about tomorrow. I just live from day to day. I don't borrow from its sunshine, for its skies may turn to gray. I don't worry o'er the future, for I know what Jesus said. And today I'll walk beside him, for he knows what is ahead. Many things about tomorrow, I don't seem to understand, but I know who holds tomorrow, and I know who holds my hand. Every step is getting brighter as the golden stairs I climb. Every burden's getting lighter, every cloud is silver lined.
There the sun is always shining, there no tear will dim the eye, and the ending of the touch the sky.
Many things about tomorrow I don't seem to understand, but I know who holds tomorrow, and I know who holds my hand. I don't know about tomorrow. It may bring me poverty, but the one who feeds the sparrow is the one who stands by me. And the path that is my portion may be through the flame or flood, but His presence goes before me, and I'm covered with His blood. Many things about tomorrow I don't seem to understand, but I know who holds tomorrow, and I know who holds my hand.
And because He lives,
I can face tomorrow, because He lives, all fear is gone, because I know He holds the future, and life is just because He lives.
Good thing I didn't close them. they would have lost their song. Anyway, thank you so much. Isn't that a good reminder? A great reminder to us today. Well, we have that privilege and opportunity to bring in some new members this morning. So you all get to watch and pray for them as they join our church. If they will come at this time, appreciate it. Should I have them up front looking towards you? You've seen enough of me. Yeah. There you guys go, right up there. And put the thorn in the middle. I mean, the rose in the middle. Which one's the thorn and the rose? All right. Find the right page. You'd think a pastor would be prepared. Dearly beloved, the privileges and blessings that we have in association together in the Church of Jesus Christ are very sacred and precious. There is in it such hallowed fellowship as cannot otherwise be known. There is helpfulness with brotherly watch care. Sharp iron sharpens iron. And counsel as can be found only in the church. There is the godly care of a pastor with teachings of the word and the helpful inspiration of corporate worship, which is what we're doing. There's cooperation in service, accomplishing together what cannot otherwise be done. Now, the doctrines upon which the church rests are as essential to Christian experience are brief. We believe in God the Father, Son, and Holy Spirit, especially emphasize the deity of Jesus Christ and the personality of the Holy Spirit. We believe that human beings are born in sin, that they need the work of forgiveness through Christ and the new birth by the Holy Spirit. That subsequent to this, there is a deeper work of heart cleansing through the infilling of the Holy Spirit, and that to each of these works and grace, the Holy Spirit gives witness. We believe that our Lord will return, the dead will be raised, that all shall come to final judgment with its rewards and punishments. Lady and gentlemen, do you heartily believe these truths? If so, answer, I do.
I do.
Do you three acknowledge Jesus Christ as your personal Savior, and do you realize that he saves you now? I do. Desiring to unite with the Church of the Nazarene, do you covenant to give yourself to the fellowship and work of God in connection with it, as set forth in the covenant of Christian conduct and character of the Church of the Nazarene? Will you endeavor in every way to glorify God by humble walk, godly conversation, holy service, by devotedly giving of your means, faithful attendance upon the means of grace, abstaining from all evil? Will you seek earnestly to perfect holiness of heart and life in the fear of the Lord? I will. I welcome you to this church, to its sacred fellowship responsibilities and privileges. May the great head of the church, Jesus, bless and keep you and enable you to be faithful in all good works, that your life and witness may be effective in leading others to Christ. Amen. John, welcome you to the Church of the Nazarene. Deborah, welcome you to the Church of the Nazarene. I have to make sure I'm getting the right one. Bill, welcome you to the Church of the Nazarene. You are Bill, right?
Yes.
Okay.
You got it right.
Yeah, Debbie wrote those. All right. We don't want to do all the handshaking and everything else until after. So that'd be up to you at this point in time. Usually we walk by and we greet them and all that kind of stuff, but they felt like some people might be uncomfortable with that. So anyway, we will wave at them and clap for them and... And after church, express your appreciation and welcome them to the family of Brazil Church of the Nazarene. Amen? Sounds good? We're going to sing one more song, appropriately called The Family of God. All right. Congratulations, guys.
Hello.
I'm so glad I'm a part of the family of God. I've been washed in the fountain by his blood. Join hands with Jesus as we travel this side. For I'm part of the family, the family.
You will notice we say brother and sister around here. It's because we're a family and these folks are so dear. When one's the heartache, we all have the tears and rejoice in each victory in this family so dear.
So glad I'm a part of the family of God. I've been washed in the fountain, cleansed by his blood. Joy dares to Jesus as we travel this side. For I'm part of the family of God. From the door of an orphanage to
I'm not worthy to be here, but praise God, I belong. I'm so glad I'm a part of the family of God. I've been washed in the fountain, cleansed by His blood. Joy dance with Jesus as we travel this far, for I'm part of the family, the family of God. For I'm part of the family, the family of God.
We see you next week, family. See ya.